Grace and peace to you this morning. Can I just start with a great biblical truth? We celebrated this wonderful time of Resurrection Sunday last weekend that Christ is still risen. Hallelujah. Praise God. Well, before we commence our time of worship and praise, some notices. Now, where's April gone? It's just gone, isn't it? Next week, we're in 1st of May. Praise God. And that means, therefore, that our service next week, there is one, and it's at 10:30. Yeah? Okay, so just remember that. And we have our to-be-soon pastor coming to join us, and he will be bringing God's word next week. So we've got Jason with us next week. So praise God for that. Then in the evening, we have our praise and testimony evening, following that at 6:30 in the evening. And this is the week. I'm going back to this is the week it was. I'm showing my age now, aren't I? This is the week of Fun Family Friday, 6:30 here on Friday. Yay. 6 o'clock. Yay. 6 p.m. Thank you, Ian. Tangerine, but doesn't matter. And so please support that. If you're not coming in person, support it in prayer. Yeah? Because it's a great outreach. So we have Daniel Moore with us this morning from New Tribes, who's bringing God's word. There he is. He's at the back there. Thank you, Daniel. And I noticed that he's preaching after me, so it's clearly I'm his warm-up man. And he did say to me in the break, you hold him and I'll hit him. So we've got that to look forward to. So let's prepare our hearts as we come before our God to worship him. And I'm going to read some verses from Psalm 34. Now, this is apposite because in the passage that Daniel will be bringing to us this morning, there are some words from Psalm 34, and I'll read those lines of scripture up to that reading, and it puts it in some sort of context here as David writes these words under persecution and yet to face further persecution. So let's listen to God's word. I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. My soul makes its boast in the Lord. Let the humble hear and be glad. Oh, magnify the Lord with me and let us exalt his name together. I sought the Lord and he answered me. I delivered me from all my fears. Those who look to him are radiant and their faces shall never be ashamed. This poor man cried, and the Lord heard him and saved him out of all his troubles. The angel of the Lord encamps around those who fear him and delivers them. Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the man who takes refuge in him. Oh, fear the Lord, or you his saints. For those who fear him have no lack. The young lions suffer want and hunger, but those who seek the Lord lack no good thing. Come, O children, listen to me. I will teach you the fear of the Lord. Father God, it's so good that we can declare continually that you are risen. And in our response to you, be with us as we sing your praises, as we encourage each other in our worship, as we come before you in prayer, and as we come under the authority of your word. Would you change our hearts? Would you encourage us? Would you conform us to that image? So as we leave this place, we can be lights for you and point to your goodness, your grace, and your glory. And we pray these things in and through the name of Jesus. Amen. We're going to stand and sing two songs together in our worship. We're going to sing People of the Risen King, followed by O Lord, My Rock and My Redeemer. And during that second song, we are going to worship by taking up our offering. So let's stand and sing together.
From the midst of a very unstable world, it's wonderful to know that we have a rock upon which to stand. The psalmist wrote in Psalm 18, "The Lord is my rock, my fortress, and my deliverer." So let's sing, "O Lord, my rock and my redeemer." Such an unstable world, Lord, that you are sovereign, that you are the Lord of history, and we trust in you, Lord, that you are going to return and you are going to make all things right and you will make everything new. Lord, what a hope we have. Lord, you are a rock, you are a redeemer. In you, Lord, we have security, we have eternal life through trusting in you, Lord Jesus. Oh, thank you, Lord, that truly, truly you are a rock, you are our Redeemer. Thank you, Lord, for these gifts that we've been able to give today, and pray that you would use them, Lord, in the extension of your kingdom in this world. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Please be seated.
I am wearing my Grimsby Baptist Church hat, but I need to change it, take that hat off, and put on my Good News for Everyone hat. And can I invite my carer and beautiful assistant up to help me? So we've got slide one. Oh, it's there. That's good. Well, first of all, I want to just say thank you and for having us as Good News for Everyone. It's a ministry that Jude and I are involved in, and there are quite a number of people within our church community that are also part of this wonderful ministry. If we have our next slide, please. This ministry started a life as Gideon's over 100 years ago. And I think there's a picture behind me of the first hotel that we actually put Bibles into, because you've all seen the Bibles in the hotels. It was in 1908. Not me, anyway. But to that end, this organization has given out something like 2.2 billion Bibles and Testaments worldwide. We are now changed our name. We have a new name within the United Kingdom called Good News for Everyone. And we put, next slide please, we put Bibles out on the highways and byways of life, where people gather, where people are in need of those Bibles. We've all seen the ones in hotels there, which we have when you go into a hotel, and they should be in the bedside cabinet, in hospitals, in nursing homes. And the one we're going to talk about most this morning, in schools. Maybe those some younger ones have received their school Bibles already, and some older ones will have kept those that have been given some years ago. And we also do them in prisons and also in badged organisations. We do them for own organisations where people gather, and they can have their own emblem on those badges. But you can come and talk to us about that afterwards. But the most prolific that we do give out, in one sense, is that we all have access to these, we call them personal worker testaments. Next slide, please. And these we carry about our person, that at some point God will place somebody in front of us, we might be able to just give them it, or we might be able to open it and share God's word with them. What a great privilege that is. But I want to go on to our next slide, and Jude's going to spend a few minutes talking about the most precious ministry that we have, really, and that is of our schools ministry. Jude. Yes. I think so.
No.
Is that on? Yeah.
As Jeremy says, we've been involved in the ministry now for getting on 15 years, I think. And it's been such a great privilege, and I have that honour of being the school's coordinator. It seemed quite natural it might be forced to me with my background in education. So we've now got a big, and we really would value your prayers, because we've got a big job on now. We're trying to catch up from pre-COVID. Obviously, the school's closed to us. So what we're trying to do now is doing a really big catch-up to give out Bibles to the years 8 as well as the year 7, which is what we would normally do. So we would really value your prayers on that. The one thing that some of you, in fact a lot of you probably know, is that the unique thing about Gideon's Bible is that it has a fantastic help section in the front, and it's alphabetical. And this is something that I always point out during our school's presentation to the children. We used to show a little video to them, but now we just talk through some issues that face the children. And if I just give you an example of this, on Friday we were blessed with a visit to Caister Yarborough School, and I'm just aware that we don't have too much time, but I want to share this with you because it is really special. Now, for many, many years, Caister Yarborough didn't allow us in. There were some issues there in the leadership, and so we and other faith groups actually were not invited in. And then we had there was a change of headship, and we made another contact, and we were welcomed with open arms, and we've been going in since. And in fact, the first time we went in after it sort of was closed, we actually covered the whole school with a youth testament, which was fantastic. So we went in this Friday and we had a little catch up with the year eights and the year sevens, and we discussed what are the key issues that face you now. You know, we're talking about 11, 12 and 13 year olds, and what are the key things that face you as you walk through life. And one or two were, we had a few hands went up, but the first hand went up, a little girl who said, "I suffer with anxiety." So she was 11 or 12, and I said, "Well, that is very common to us all." And I said, "Well, in here, if you look up in the front, you'll see A for anxiety, and there might well be something in here that could help you." We don't proselytise. We're not going in there to schools to convert. Let me just point that out to you. We're going in to share this word, to give them this as a gift, and then it's their choice there on in. The other thing that I want to mention is that 3 years ago, before lockdown, we went into a certain school not far away from here, and it was a packed audience, and there was a little boy who clearly got some issues, and I'm going to put this as delicately as I might, that he had some identity issues, and he was a very sweet little boy, and we were discussing life's issues, such as relationships. Jeremy, what else? We talk about relationships, we talk about falling out, we talk about bullying, death, that's right. All those sort of issues. Are the twins here? Do you remember us coming? Where are you, darlings? Yes. You remember us coming to Tolbar, don't you? And yeah. And sorry, I should have asked you what we said and see if you remember. I can't remember. So at the end we proffer them, we say, "You don't have to take one. This is a free gift." And sometimes, you know, if they're a bit like this, I say, "Don't worry, it's not going to bite. You can take it now. You might read it in 20 years' time, but this is, you know, it's a gift. You don't have to take it." And the little boy came up, and he just stared at me, and he proffered his hand out, and I gave him it. He said, "I think I'm really going to need this." And it was, you know, my heart was pounding, and it was just the most beautiful thing. And if no other child, you know, I think there were 200 there that morning, and if no other child was touched by that, then he was. And just like the little girl on Friday, because when we were just talking at the end, she was nodding like that and looking at me, you know. And it really was such a blessing to do this. So That's it. And sorry, yes. And I've just been talking to Andy, who's, as you know, is head of one of our primary schools locally. The ministry have now put out a super magazine that's aimed at primary schools. We've always gone into secondary schools, but this one is called Discover, and we're getting it out into primary schools. So I've been giving it out to one or two people. Actually, our local school, which is literally 5 minutes from where we live in the back of Beyond, called me, and I had a lovely half an hour with the RE teacher, who was thrilled to bits to receive this, and she wants to bring the children here to look at the baptistry and meet us. So that's great, isn't it? So that's a super connection that we've got there. So, yeah.
So this points to why we're here. Next slide. We're not here for money. We're not here, but we are here for your prayer support. We want you to pray for these things, that these Bibles will be opened by the children in those schools, that they'll receive the gift of the Bibles and the Discover magazine, and the Holy Spirit will be at work in that and to do that. And you could support us a little bit more. Next slide. You could become officially a friend of ours, in which you'd get a quarterly magazine, and you would also get access to these Bibles. We put, and you would be able to get and take them, and we would inform you and supply you with them as you would need to do that. Or I know there are a number from this church, but there can be more. If you want to feel that God is prompting you to join us and be part of this organization, please come and see us afterwards, because where men and women are, and I think we need to be on the next slide, do we? Yeah, no, that's right. Where men and women of the book, where men and women of prayer, where men and women of faith, of personal holiness, compassionate hearts, who witness to others. What breaks our hearts is those that have an eternal destiny of doom. Just to give you an idea, the next slide of the actual potential in this area, our little branch in Grimsby gives out something like 2,500 of these youth testaments in schools each and every year. We service about 200 bedrooms in hotels, and we put out in other places as well. And of course, don't forget that we give out quite a number of these personally, individually, each and every year, personal worker testaments. So you can join now, because we are Good News for Everyone, as a man, as a woman in your own right, or as a couple. And if you want to talk to us about that and pray about that with us later, we'd be here to do that. Thank you very much for listening to us. Bless you. Steve.
Children will be heading out after this next song, which is very appropriately facing a task unfinished that drives us to our knees.
We are going to pray together. What a great privilege and joy that is. So let us bow our heads together and pray. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to hell. The third day he rose again from the dead, and he ascended to heaven, and is seated at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Universal Church, the communion of the saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Father God, we thank you so much for these truths of who you are by your word. And Father, we would pray in grace and humility to work in our lives to reflect your glory and proclaim that good news about the risen Lord Jesus and his gift of abundant life now and for eternity with him. Oh Father, we've just celebrated Resurrection Sunday when you conquered in victory. And Father, we would pray that you would conquer in victory for those people in the Ukraine that are suffering this morning. Would you conquer in love and grace? And Father, would your people be at work there pointing to your love and to your glory for those who have lost everything on this earth? And Father, we would pray for those that are coming through the Homes for Ukrainian scheme, that you would be at work and free that blocked system, allowing those that are due, God willing, to come here, that you would be at work so that they could travel. And Father, we pray for all those in our community here at Grimsby Baptist Church who are suffering, both spiritually, physically, and in bereavement. Let us take a moment to lift our personal prayers of intercession to our Father God, knowing that the Lord Jesus is interceding for us. Father, what breaks your heart should break ours, and indeed in many cases does, Lord, as we lift those of our family and friends that do not yet know you. And all those, Father, that through this place, this ministry within this community of Grimsby Baptist Church, we are trying to reach for the kingdom. Those through, as we go into schools through the work of Margaret, the mums and little ones through that work at Tots. And indeed we do lift again Fun Family Friday to you, as we may see over 100 people in this building this week to hear the gospel. Father, and we do lift those para organizations that seek to show your love and to share the gospel in this community. We do pray for good news for everyone in that ministry as they continue to give out your word. And we pray for all those that we have given out and in schools, that those Bibles, those testaments will be opened, and Holy Spirit, you will be at work. We pray for safe families too as they seek to witness the love of Christ in families in great need. And we pray for them that they will continue to go from strength to strength and you will use them for your glory. And Lord, we pray for each of ourselves that as you place people on the path of life in front of us, the first of all through our lives, that we would be able to show them Christ in some way. First, that they would ask the question, and we will be able to give the reason for the hope that we have in you. Father, our youth have just gone out to their classes. Father, we pray for them. We pray for their teachers, and we pray that they will have open ears and minds to the gospel as it's taught to them right now. Be at work in those young people's lives. Encourage them, exhort them, uphold them, we pray. And we pray for Daniel. We thank you for him as he is prepared to bring your word. And we pray that you will use him for your glory. And Father, we pray for our own minds and hearts that you will renew them and that you will indeed change our hearts and conform us to the image of your Son as the word is brought. And Father, in all things, we seek your wisdom and guidance in what you have for us in this place as Grimsby Baptist Church. As we move forward, help us to be responsive to you through the Holy Spirit. Work in our lives, we pray, and glorify yourself through all we do in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Can you imagine living in this dark world? Can you imagine going through life without a light to guide you? Well, God has given us that light, and that light is his word. That's why Good News for Everyone gives out Bibles in schools and in hotels. That's why we're just about to have God's word read to us. That's why Daniel is going to preach God's word to us, because as the psalmist said in Psalm 119, thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path.
To my feet. Our reading today is from 1 Peter chapter 3. And if you've got a church Bible, it's found on page 1015. We're going to read verses 8 to 12. Finally, all of you have unity of mind, sympathy, brotherly love, a tender heart, and a humble mind. Do not repay evil for evil or reviling for reviling, but on the contrary, bless. For to this you were called, that you may obtain a blessing. For whoever desires to love life and see good days, let him keep his tongue from evil and his lips from speaking deceit. Let him turn away from evil and do good. Let him seek peace and pursue it. For the eyes of the Lord are on the righteous, and his ears are open to their prayer. But the face of the Lord is against those who do evil.
Well, good morning, and let's just begin with a word of prayer. Ask the Lord to help us with his word. Lord, we thank you for the privilege that we have to open your word in our language. We thank you that you speak through your word. And Lord, we want the Holy Spirit to perform his ministry and work here this morning to speak through the word to each of our hearts. And we'll thank you for this in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, well, we've been going through the book of 1 Peter. And as you can see from the opening slide there, some of the key themes that we have in 1 Peter is firstly Jesus, then suffering and glory. And we see at the beginning of the book of 1 Peter that Peter addresses it to a group of people. Now, you might know that Peter and Paul divided the different areas that they were going to. Remember, Peter was the apostle to the Jews and Paul to the Gentiles. And he lists some of the areas there that he went to in his ministry. And so he's writing this letter to Jewish Christians scattered throughout Turkey. And they have under persecution. Persecution has already started. But very shortly, there is going to be widespread state-sponsored persecution. The Roman emperors began to see the Christians as a threat. And shortly after this letter was written, they're going to be encouraging people to arrest, imprison, and even put to death some of the Christians. So the receivers of this letter are facing a critical time in their history. They've already been persecuted and are suffering to a certain extent, but there is worse to come. And Peter, of course, writes this letter to encourage them and also to encourage us. And on the next slide, I've looked at this passage. I think the title that I'm going to call it is Living Godly in a Christ-Rejecting World. Living Godly in a Christ-Rejecting World. And as we get into the passage, we'll see in verses 8 and 9 that there are a whole series of commands. Now, I've been a Christian for quite a number of years now, and one of the things that discouraged me, especially early in my Christian life, was that I would look at a passage like this, and the message would go something like this: well, you need to do this, and you need to do this, and you need to do this, and you need to do this. And I left after a message like that thinking, okay, I'm going to try harder, and I would try through the week, and then come back the next week and be discouraged. Now, you'll notice if you look carefully in the epistles, the letters, that the writers don't usually just give you commands. Usually they give teaching first that explains how and why we're going to be able to fulfill these commands. So that's what we're going to do this morning. We're going to look at these commands and we're going to ask how we can live godly in a Christ-rejecting world and then why. But before we do that, shall I give you the answer first? If you have a car and the car has no engine, then it's a pretty hard job getting that thing going, isn't it? It's a big struggle and a push. And you know what? My Christian life for many years was like that. I was trying to push the car without regards for the fact there was an engine in the car that was not being used. So here's the problem. The problem is that these commands we are not able to fulfill. Even as believers, in our own strength, we cannot fulfill them. It says there, for example, one of the commands is to love others. Well, I don't know what Christians you know, but some of the Christians I know are quite lovely, and some of them less so. And it's the less lovely ones that cause me the problems, because I don't really feel like loving them. And if I look within myself, I'm not going to find the ability to love them. It's just simply not there. So what we're going to see here is that there are people, and one person in particular, Christ, that we are to look to. So Christ is the one who we look to him, and we will have the ability to fulfill his commands. Paul writes in Ephesians, and he says, you know, the same power that got Jesus out the tomb, the resurrection life that was given to Jesus when God the Father raised him from the dead, is the same power that you have as a Christian when you first believe the gospel. It's not a different power. It's not a different resurrection life. The same resurrection life that raised Jesus from the dead, that is how you're to live. And so if, like me, maybe you've struggled in the Christian life, trying as hard as you can, and it's not working. It's because the engine, the power, is the resurrection of life in Christ, in you and me. And that is what you need to look to be able to walk with the Lord. So let's have a look here. We see, first of all, Christ's example. Christ focus, to put our eyes on Christ, is the way to help us to walk with the Lord. And think about Jesus' example. He's going to talk here about not reviling, not insulting people back, loving people who are not particularly lovely. And Jesus is the ultimate example. Think about his arrest. They arrested him, they beat him, they spat upon him, they insulted him. At the cross, it got worse. They gathered around him and they said all kinds of vile and disgusting things about the Lord Jesus Christ. And did he respond? No, he didn't respond in the way that they were provoking him with. And then, next slide, another example that we see in the Bible of looking to Jesus is Peter. So Peter is walking on the water. And we notice from the story in Matthew 14, this amazing miracle. Peter's the only one who ever walked on the water apart from the Lord Jesus. And we know the story. As long as Peter kept his eyes on the Lord, he could do the impossible. He was walking on water, just like Jesus did. But as soon as he started looking around at the storms and the waves and the wind, looking around at his circumstances, took his eyes off Jesus, down he went. And that's my experience in the Christian life. When I have my eyes on the Lord, I can do the impossible. I can live the Christian life. These commands here, you cannot do. They are divine. Only people who are walking in the Spirit, following God, only they can fulfill them in your life. So I didn't want to start this morning by giving you all these commands, and then you think, okay, well, off we go and do them. You won't be able to do them. We have to keep our eyes on Christ. But notice the grace of Jesus. Even though Peter takes his eyes off the Lord, as soon as he says, Lord, save me, Jesus steps in and picks him up. And the same Jesus who did that, he's here today to say, look, if you're struggling, I'm here to help you. I'm not here to condemn you. I'm here to help you. And the third example that's here in this passage is David. Now, Jeremy read for us Psalm 34 in the introduction. And that's very helpful. If you look at the first verse, it tells you that this was when David was pretending to be mad. And he was in trouble. He was in the Philistine camp. He was in their town. And he was afraid of death. And he trusted in God to help him. David was being persecuted by Saul. And after this, the next thing he had to do was go back to Israel, and his persecution got worse. But you know, when David had his eyes on God and not on himself, he was able to do the impossible. So today, as we look at this passage, keep that in mind. It's not possible for us to do in our own strength. We can only do these things as we look to God. So he starts off in verse 8, and he says, finally. Now, finally might be a preacher's favorite word, but we all know that it doesn't mean what it says. But Peter here isn't saying finally because he's got to the end of his message and then he's going to string it out for another three chapters. He's saying finally because when we look at what he's been talking about, he's bringing a section to a close. He started off in chapter 2, verses 13 to 17, talking about government and how we should honor the king, how we should respect government. And bear in mind, the persecution that's coming is state-sponsored persecution. So that's a significant thing. He's still telling us, even if people are acting in a wicked government-sanctioned way, you can still, as a believer, be respectful to them. And then secondly, he mentions slaves and masters, which, of course, nowadays we talk about employees and employers, that relationship that we still have here, chapter 2, verses 18 to 25. And then a few weeks ago, Stephen Cuthbert looked at the passage about husbands and wives in chapter 3. So different groups that are being addressed. And now Peter's bringing it all together and he's saying, look, here are some commands for all of you together to think about. So if we go to the next slide, that's what we're going to be thinking about. The first command here is to be united. Now, that's a difficult thing for me to say as a supporter of a certain football team, but to be united. Now, he says here to have unity of mind, to have unity of mind. Now, unity of mind is not the same thing as uniformity, okay? Uniformity typically flourishes in dictatorships, where one person's in the charge and everyone else has to think just like them or else. That is not what Peter has in mind here. Let's look at Philippians chapter 2 on the next slide, and let's see what Paul says about this, because it's very much in the same vein. So in verse 2 of Philippians chapter 2, he says, complete my joy by being of the same mind, having the same love. Oh, that shows up later in the Peter passages. Being in full accord and of one mind. And then he gives the example, and notice, he points back to Jesus. Jesus is the model, Jesus is the example. He's going to show us what does this mean. So he says, have this mind among you, which was yours in Christ Jesus, who though he was in the form of God, did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped. So for Jesus, it wasn't that he had to be the prominent one. Jesus was willing to be the servant and humble himself. Verse 7 says, he emptied himself by taking the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of men. And being found in a human form, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Jesus was willing to go through this suffering, and he was humbled doing so. And the result, verse 9, therefore God has highly exalted him and bestowed on him the name that is above every name. So just like in Peter, we see suffering leads to glory. The problem is, we want the glory, and we're not so keen on the suffering. But you can't have it. That's the way it goes. Suffering first, glory later on. So to be of one mind is to keep the main thing the main thing. You can have differences of opinion about how to do different things in the church. That's fine. Paul is saying, let's keep the main thing the main thing. And what are those main things? They are to share the gospel. They are to honor Christ in everything that this church does. And it is to build up the believers in the faith. Those are the main things that every church should be doing. And that's what we can be united on. We can say, yes, we're going to get involved with this. We're going to do this together. The second one that's mentioned there is to be loving. To be loving, verse 8. And there are three different ways that Peter suggests that we might be loving. The first is sympathy. Sympathy, that's the feeling with somebody else. Jesus said that we should weep with those who weep. We can rejoice with those who rejoice. And in a church, the believers should together can be sympathetic. They can feel with. The second one he mentions is brotherly love, phileo. And we looked last time at the different words for love. And we looked at agape, which is that God's divine self-sacrificial love, predominantly shown by Jesus dying for us on the cross. Well, phileo is the brotherly love. And for those who've ever been in combat, you might understand this word very well. Because you see, when you're in combat with somebody, when you're fighting and your life's on the line, their life's on the line, when you together go through that experience, the bond between those people is often lifelong. Because the depth of the relationship. Now, hopefully in the church, we're not having that kind of fight. But what we can do is, as we serve together in different ministries, we learn to grow and appreciate each other's gifts and different personalities and experiences. And that way, brotherly love can flourish, because we're all part of the same family. So whether you're involved in the services, whether you're involved in the music, whether you're involved in the youth ministry, or any of the other ministries that are a part of the church, phileo, brotherly love, is something that we can all do and practice. not from ourselves, as we'll see in a minute, but relying upon God. The third one here, tender-hearted, is not very typical of the Romans. The Romans despised people who were tender-hearted or who pitied other people. Pity and tender-hearted, that's for the weak. Okay, so don't go to the Roman army looking for that kind of stuff. You won't get it, okay? They viewed that as a very weak thing. But here, Peter says, no, this is something that is valuable to God, to be tender-hearted. So let me ask you a question. Let's suppose that some difficult situation comes in your life and you're feeling hurt. What kind of a person would you like to go to? Would you like to go to somebody who's tender-hearted? Or would you like to go to somebody who says, pull up your socks, stop crying, you know, stop blubbing, you know, just get on with it, you know. We all recognize that when we've been hurt, we want somebody who's tender-hearted. And hopefully there'll be that amongst us here. Then he mentions in verse 8 again, to be humble or to be humble-minded. Again, this is not thinking of ourselves, but thinking about others. Not being self-focused, but being Christ-focused. Now, there's a certain sin that is the opposite of all three of those. It makes it difficult for people to be united, this particular sin. It makes it difficult for people to be loving, and it makes it difficult for people to be humble. I wonder if you can think what sin it is. I'll give you some more clues. This is the first sin in the universe. Yes, it's pride. We read about the first sin in the universe in Ezekiel 28. Ezekiel 28, 11 to 19 there, describes Lucifer as this angel that was given special intelligence, that was more beautiful, more intelligent than some of the other angels. Lucifer was in Eden. He was perfect. And then it says in verse 17, it says, his heart became proud because of his beauty. Do you know what Lucifer did? Lucifer should have been looking to God. And he looked in here. He looked at himself, looked at his intelligence, looked at his appearance, and he said, I am something special. That was the first sin. Okay, that was the first sin in the universe, where he looked within instead of looking to God. And it says in verse 17, it says, you corrupted your wisdom for the sake of your splendor. He then became Satan, the adversary of God, and he was cast out, it says, of the mountain of God. Of course, the first thing that he did as Satan was to come down to the earth to find out those individuals, Adam and Eve, there in the Garden of Eden. And what did he tempt them with? Genesis 3:5, you will be like God. You will be like God. There it is. Now, those of you good at maths, 28 divided by 2, 14, okay? So if you want to remember where there's two passages that talk about Lucifer and his fall, the first one is Ezekiel 28. If you halve 28, you get 14, and it's Isaiah 14. And you'll see there five times Satan says, I will, I will, I will, I will, I will, I will take the place of God. And that's what happened. That was the first sin. He comes down to the earth, Adam and Eve, you will be like God. Pride. And so Adam and Eve fell. And if you look through the whole Bible and right down to today, you're going to find it's the same issue. It's always, am I God-focused or self-focused? As a Christian, I can be God-focused, Christ-focused, but I can also be self-focused. And guess which God wants me to be? So those commands that are given there to be united, to be loving and to be holy, to be humble, they are impossible if we're self-focused. Now, where are we going to get love from? Okay, I've mentioned that there are some Christians that are lovely and some Christians who are not so lovely. So what are we going to do about them? Where am I going to get love from to love the unlovely? Well, on the next slide is an illustration here from Romans chapter 5, verse 5. This is a really important verse that I believe it's helped me, maybe help a lot of people. And it's to realize this, that the love of God is not something that you have to make up. You don't have to sit there and, you know, clench your fist, I am going to love them. That's not it. That's not going to work. It says there in Romans 5, verse 5, now hope does not disappoint because the love of God has been poured out in our hearts by the Holy Spirit who was given to us. If you're a Christian, if you've believed the gospel, you've believed Jesus Christ died on the cross for your sins and rose again, if you've believed that and you're saved, That's what God wants to do. He wants to pour his love through your life. You aren't meant to make it up. You can't. This is divine love from God himself. You can't do it. But if you look to Christ and you ask the Holy Spirit to help you, he will do it for you. It's his work and it's his ministry. So what do I need to do? Well, I don't need to be a blockage in the pipe, do I? Right? I don't need my stubbornness, myself, my flesh. I don't need that blocking up God's willingness to shed his love through my heart to other people. So it's possible. You know, when Jesus was on the cross, he said, "It's finished." Now, when he said it's finished, he did mean that there's nothing for you to do to earn heaven. He meant that. He meant that your sins, past, present, and future, were all paid for on the cross. He did mean that. But do you realize he also meant everything you need to live as a Christian was also done for you on the cross. You can't live the Christian life. You cannot please God as you are. Okay, here's two ways to live. We can live a have-to life, or we can live a thank-you life. Let's go for the have-to life. Let me ask you some questions about last week. See if this encourages you. Okay, how many hours did you spend reading the Bible last week? Not enough. Okay, how long did you spend praying last week? Not enough. I used to have a little sign on my bedroom wall at university, and it said, "Hindus get up at 4 a.m. Now, I put it there to stimulate me to get out of bed and to encourage me that if the Hindus can do it, I should be able to do it. I tell you what, it didn't work. It just gets discouraging. I couldn't do it. Okay, what about how many people you witnessed to this week? It's going to be not enough. Do you see, every time, if you're going to be performance-based as a Christian, you're just going to have a lifetime of discouragement because it's never good enough. But God doesn't accept you on that basis. Ephesians 1 says, we are accepted in the Beloved. Why? Because we agreed with God about what he said about Jesus. That's what faith is, to believe. Jesus. God said, "My son died on the cross for your sins and rose again." Do you believe that? And at some point in my life, I said, "Yes, God, you're right. That's true. I believe that. I became a child of God." Now, he then gives you and me the resurrection power, life, to live for him. We can't do it by ourselves. So we can enjoy that. We can rest in his work for us. Another illustration, must have war on the mind or something, but about a battle. Okay, and in this war, you are there in the, and the commander wins the victory. He wins this hill on the battlefield. And then he invites you to say, "Look, I want you to go, and I've already won, but you just hold the hill." Okay, and you say, "Oh, there's another hill over there. I'd like to go and win." No, that's not your job. Okay, it's not your job to go. You just stay on this hill and you defend it. That's all you're asked to do. Do you know, as believers, that's what Christ asks. He's won the victory. He's won the hill. He just says, we need to stay on the hill and to stand on it. The chapter in Ephesians 6 that talks about spiritual warfare, it says, stand, stand, stand. It doesn't say go charging around, advancing, trying to take other territory. It just says stand. Jesus has done it all. We just stand on what he did for us on the cross and rose again. Let's move on now, next slide, and we go to verse 9. So as well as these commands that we've looked at already, here's a fourth one, and that is to make godly choices, to make godly choices in verse 9. And there's two aspects here. One is actions, don't repay evil for evil. And the second one is words, reviling for reviling, insulting for insulting. Now, some of you know, my wife and I, we lived for about 10 years in a remote part of the jungle in Papua New Guinea. And we worked with a tribe there called the Inupang. And the actual name Inupang is not their favorite name for themselves, because it's what their neighbors called them when they told the government that this group were living there. And Inupang means man-eaters. Now, as we were living with them, initially they told us, well, we weren't cannibals, but he said, the people in the next way over there, they're the teeth people. Now, they used to eat people. Ever since Adam and Eve, everyone's always been blaming somebody else. Well, we lived there long enough to discover not only did those people eat people, but so did the people in our village as well. Fortunately, they had given that up by the time we moved in. Now, in that culture that we lived in, there was something called payback. It's very common in Papua New Guinea amongst the people there. And the idea is that if somebody kills somebody in your clan, you pay them back. And so they did this for generations. It was killing, killing, killing. And there's no end to it. There's never any end to that kind of a lifestyle of killing and endless payback until the gospel comes, of course. Now, that's not just out there. If we look across the world today, we can see examples of somebody does something to somebody, they're going to pay them back or do something even worse. That's what human beings do. But you know what? God's ways are different. The world says, well, evil for evil. And if somebody does good to you, yeah, you can do good back. But God does good to those who are evil. When did Christ die for me? When I was a good Christian? Romans 5:8, while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. The only thing you contributed to your salvation was what? Your sin. You bring it along to God and say, this is my contribution, Lord. You know, this is me earning my way to heaven. This is all I can bring. You bring your sin. And God says, okay, I'll forgive that through Christ. All we're doing is responding in the gospel. We're just saying, thank you, God, for what you've done. We don't earn our way to heaven. Now, verse 9 is very similar to in chapter 1 Peter 2, 21 to 23. So if you could put that on the screen for us, please. I think it's the next slide. We see there here, again, this idea that let's go back to the example of Jesus. If I look in here about my performance, we're going to get discouraged. So Peter says, look at Jesus. Look what Jesus did. And in chapter 2, he said this. He said, to this you've been called because Christ also suffered for you, leaving you an example. Christ is our example. Let's model our lives on him. Because he leaving an example so that you might also follow in his steps. He committed no sin, neither was deceit found in his mouth. Now, isn't that interesting? Because that comes up just a couple of verses later on here. When he was reviled, he was insulted in a vulgar way. He did not revile in return. When he suffered, he did not threaten, but continued entrusting himself to him who judges justly. I often wondered, why does Jesus get baptized with the Holy Spirit before he starts his ministry? You ask yourself that question. Interesting, isn't it? I mean, he's God. He's God the body. He never sinned, right? So those who were coming to John the Baptist for to be baptized to show that they were sorry for their sin, that's not in it. But you see, Jesus was being our model. Jesus showed us that throughout ministry as believers, we need the Holy Spirit because he set the model. Jesus did it. He showed us that you can't live the Christian life without the Holy Spirit being with you. And when does the Holy Spirit come to us? Well, the Bible says in 1 Corinthians 12, verse 13, Paul said, when you believe the gospel, you are baptized or put into the body of Christ. That's what happens when you believe the gospel. You hear the gospel, you say, God, that's right. Jesus died on the cross for my sins. You're born again. The Holy Spirit is given to you and you are put into the body of Christ. So baptism for an individual happens once. Filling of the Spirit, though, that's an ongoing thing. So now that I'm a Christian, when I go through life and I sin, God's saying to me, look, confess your sin, go back to God, ask for cleansing based on what Jesus did for you, and ask to be filled with the Spirit. And you can be. Okay? God is not mean with the Holy Spirit. He wants you to walk in the power of the Holy Spirit, not in the power of our flesh and our effort. So there's a past reason why we should live godly, because Jesus did. The next one is a present reason, our present purpose. If we look back in the previous chapter, 1 Peter 2, verse 9, it says there, you are a royal priesthood. You are a king priest, or queen priest, if you want. Okay, but you are a royal priest. So you have this role both of future reign with Christ, but you also have this priestly present role. Now, what does a priest do? Well, a priest stands between God and people as an intermediate. They pray for the people to God. They work as this intermediate. And that's your role. That's my role with the people of the world. They're not going to pray to God. My role and your role is to be priests to them. Now, one of the functions of the priest is to bless others. Some of you are familiar with Numbers chapter 6. And the priest would say, may the Lord bless you and keep you. Okay, that's the priests blessing the people. And that's one of our functions, is to bless others. Look at Christ. Did Christ bless people? Think about the cross. They nailed his hands and his feet, and as they're nailing him, he says, Father, forgive them. Because if he hadn't, God could have destroyed everyone in that whole place. But he prayed for them, and God saved at least two people right there and then. Okay, remember the Roman centurion said, truly, this is the Son of God. And we know the dying thief, another example of blessing. Jesus said to him, today you will be with me in paradise. He did nothing to earn salvation. He didn't even go to church, read his Bible, pray, didn't do one thing good for God. He just believed that Jesus died for him. And that was enough. He's in heaven. And the third example we saw there is Jesus turns to his mother and he says, woman, behold your son. Son, behold your mother. So look at Jesus. As Jesus is dying in the worst agony possible, he's blessing. He's blessing. He's blessing. And he's setting us a model. He's setting us a pattern to do. The future example is there in verse at the end of verse 9. And that says to inherit a blessing. Now, some translations say obtain a blessing, but the word there is the inherit word. And if you want a bit of Sunday afternoon fun, then get your Bible concordance out and have a look at reward and inheritance. And you will find there are dozens and dozens of verses in the New Testament where God says, do you know what? If you serve me, I'm not just going to say that's fine. I'm going to reward you when you get to heaven. Now, why does God want to do that? Hey, I'm not going to argue with God. But God has decided that that's what he's going to do. So, for example, in Matthew 10:42, it says there, even a cup of cold water given to a disciple will be remembered and rewarded. And it's about this time in the message that I think I need one of these. So thank you very much for that. But that verse was actually talking about people. It talked about the apostles going out two by two. And so somebody in a village sees the two apostles coming along, let's say Peter and John, and they realize that these are men of God coming to bring God's message. And so this person says, goes out to them, would you like a cup of cold water? Would you like some food? Would you like a place to stay? And you know what? When Peter and John go around preaching in that village, whatever reward they one day get from God the Father, God says, the same reward that I give to them, I'm going to give to you as well. Is that generous? Does God have to do that? So think about the friends. Everything that you've ever done for God, he's remembered, and one day he's going to reward. So that's a reason to want to live like this, isn't it? Grace on grace. We don't deserve it. We don't ought to be given it, but he gives it us anyway. And then just this last section here about the verses from Psalm 34. We see some repetition here. We see, for example, he repeats the present purpose in verses 10 and 11. He tells them to make godly choices. For example, hold your tongue from evil words and your lips from deceit. Sometimes people say, well, you know, it's their fault. Other people annoy me and I can't help what I say. So imagine here, there's two people arguing and they're really getting into it and one's really frustrated. I can't stand you. You make me so mad. All of a sudden the phone rings. Hello? Yes? Mm-hmm. Yeah? Okay. I'll be fine. Yeah. Tomorrow. Thank you. You see, we say that we can't control our words, but we don't lack the ability, we lack the incentive or the motivation. That's true, isn't it? We can say it's somebody else's fault, but the reality is I am making a choice. When I use my words, I'm making choices about what I say. And it's not the other person's fault, because I could control it. If this couple was offered £1 million to have no arguments over 6 weeks, guess what? They'd do it. So God tells us we can do this. We can do this. How can we do it? Well, let's look at 1 Corinthians 10, verse 4 and 5. You can put it on the screen for us. Here, Paul tells us the secret of what we are to do. How can we control our minds? And Paul says this. He says, the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty in God for pulling down strongholds, casting down arguments and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, bringing every thought into captivity to the obedience of Christ. You see, friends, this is our job. This is my job, day by day, week by week. A bad thought comes into my mind. Well, I can say, welcome into my living room of my mind. Come, would you like a cup of tea? Yeah, okay. And put your feet up. I can make the choice to start chewing on that thought. That's sin. That's sin. I'm making choices about what I think about. Or those thoughts come into mind, and I have to tell you, I've had some horrible thoughts. Well, I can say to that thought, I don't accept that I have to think like this. I don't. I'm going to choose to think about something else. Or if it keeps bothering me, I'm going to change activity. I'm going to leave that place, go somewhere else, and do something else. Paul is talking about not being passive. He's saying, take thought captive to God. Think about something else. Philippians 4:8 encourages us to do the same. Whatever is true, etc., think about these things. And Colossians 3:2, set your mind on things above, not on things on the earth. The last two verses, again about choices, turn away from evil and do good. Again, we aren't going to be able to do this, only in the power and help of the Holy Spirit. And finally, verse 12, we have a fourth reason that is given for us here. Why should we seek to live godly in this present age? Because of God's character. Because of God's character. God sees all, he says. God knows all. He answers all. All those who cry out to him, he hears their prayers and answers. And he says there, God is against those who do evil. Now, just remember, in context, he's not talking about unbelievers. He's not talking about unbelievers. He's talking about you and I as believers. Can I be doing evil in the church? I can. I can be gossiping. Can I be doing evil in the church? I can be slandering. I can be exaggerating my own importance or my own ministry. I can do lots of things where I'm actually doing evil. And the warning in this passage, Peter says, is don't be like that, right? Make the right choices to do what God wants us to do. Well, if you're here this morning and you don't know the Lord, or you're not sure that your sins are forgiven and going to heaven, please have a word afterwards. I've got a couple of booklets here called Trust in Christ, which will tell you how you can be sure that your sins are forgiven. And if you are a believer, then maybe there's thought for us. All of us, we cannot keep these commands of God. They're impossible. We need to fix our eyes on Jesus, ask the Holy Spirit to help us, and he will do that. Let me close with a word of prayer. Lord, we thank you for this truth. We just pray that you would help us to live these things out. And Lord, we'll do it by trusting in you and the power of your Holy Spirit within us. And pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you, Daniel. Well, in God's power, we can be united. We can love one another. So let's stand and just affirm our love for one another through the power of the Spirit as we sing, "Oh, how good it is when the family of God dwell together in spirit, in faith, and unity."
The family of God dwell together.
Let's pray. Now to him who is able to strengthen you according to my gospel and the preaching of Jesus Christ, according to the revelation of the mystery that was kept secret for long ages, but now has been disclosed and through prophetic writings has been made known to all nations, according to the command of the eternal God to bring about the obedience of faith. To the only wise God be glory forevermore through Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
May the Lord bless you and keep you. Please speak to Daniel about the sermon if you wish, or if you want to speak about good news for everyone, come and see Jude and I at the front. Bless you all.